everything you do creates a counter reaction in the outer world. That means you can't just look at yourself, you also have to look at your relationship to others. The people that you fall in love with, the people that you become interested in. In today's video, we're talking about how and why opposites attract, and we're talking about the magnetic connection between an introvert and an extrovert. We're talking about how that relationship can develop over time and how you might perceive and experience such a relationship. If this is interesting to you, click the magical subscribe button and leave a like down below.
When I first saw him, I remember thinking he looked so dorky. He had this silly sweater on. It looked like something his mom had made for him. I remember one morning, I was yelling at the coffee machine because it wasn't working. He came by and just pushed some buttons, and suddenly it was working. I was happy, of course. So I asked him if he wanted to come to my place and fix my TV too. His face got all red. It was really cute. Then he asked me if I wanted to come with him to a concert. It was my favorite band. How did he know that? It was super exciting.
I was depressed when I met her. I lived a boring, mundane life. Honestly, I was stuck. But when I saw her, I felt free. Suddenly, I had courage. Suddenly, I had hope. When I was with her, I felt something besides nothingness. Something deeper, something real. I would see her everywhere I went. And suddenly, everything I did because of her. Suddenly, I had courage to say things I had never said before. I took risks I had never taken before. I don't know what got into me, but I felt happy. I felt joy. In stories, from 500 days of summer to the eternal sunshine of the spotless mind, we see just how powerful the connection between an introvert and an extrovert can be. Yeah, this is and can be the meeting of true opposites. Indeed, opposites do attract. But this kind of attraction is also a dangerous one, so you have to be mindful about with what expectations you go into such a relationship. What do you expect from this person? What kind of person do you expect them to be for you? And what are your needs and desires from such a relationship? How do you attach yourself to this experience and how do you perceive it? The psychological rule says that when an inner situation is not made conscious, it happens outside as fate. That is to say, when the individual remains undivided and does not become conscious of his inner opposite, the world must perforce act out the conflict and be torn into opposing halves. Carl Jung. Yeah, the meeting between an introvert and an extrovert can be a dramatic one. The introvert possesses an incredible, vast amount of energy within him, but he denies himself this energy out of fear. Inside, he has so many ideas and such strong values, but outside, he looks empty, he feels unachieved, he feels like he has missed his potential. The extrovert represents a thirst of life, to live fully. The active lifestyle of an extrovert and their generally positive demeanor is only contrasted by an inner state of exhaustion and pain. A lot of times, extroverts, especially unhealthy ones, can find themselves feeling like they're missing something or like they're broken on the inside. So what are the consequences of an unhealthy introvert and an unhealthy extrovert meeting, and what can they learn from each other's? What are your experiences dating an introvert or dating an extrovert? Feel free to leave your comments down below, and I hope to see you all in part 2. I hope you're subscribed for part 2 of this story, why introverts and extroverts attract, and how introverts and extroverts might perceive this magical encounter. Without further ado, let's get into the story. I don't know why she's doing this to us. I just want her to stay around forever. I needed her. To me, we were perfect. There are no problems. Honestly, everything is great. I feel like she's just trying to ruin us on purpose. When I met her, she seemed so happy, so great. But she's changed. She'd seem annoyed. And when I tried to comfort her or make her feel better, she'd snap at me. Our relationship was perfect, but she doesn't seem to want to be happy.
In the beginning, it was fun. I really enjoyed going out and trying new things together. But I felt like he was always resistant to my ideas. First, he seemed to enjoy my spontaneity, but over time, he seemed to slow me down. He always wanted to stay at home. It was frustrating. And when I started to talk about it, he acted like I was being crazy. He could be really cold and dismissive at times when I needed reassurance.
What had seemed perfect at first stops being perfect after a while. In the start of a relationship, we have what we call the honeymoon stage. But the honeymoon stage is not a full relationship. It is a relationship only with the good parts of the person we meet. It is a relationship only with the things that we idealize about the other person. It's not a relationship with that person's struggles or challenges. We go into a relationship thinking that somebody will complete us, but can they really do that? And what happens if we start trapping the other person into a certain role? What happens if we force another person to be our savior or healer? What happens if we look to somebody else to complete us, but they're not feeling complete? Honestly, what is it these two people need, and why is it that their relationship is starting to crack? Let's continue with the story. She left me, and when I lost her, I felt like I'd lost the ability to ever be happy again. I sometimes find myself feeling like I hate her. Other days, I just miss her. Now, I feel worse than ever. I didn't hate my job before, but now I do. I hate the boring, mundane, trivial things I have to do every day. I hate waking up. I hate having to go to work. I hate coming home. I don't know what to do with myself. I wish I had never met her. I wish I could just go back to how things were before.
After I lost him, I felt like I had made the greatest mistake of my life. Not even an XL bucket of Ben and Jerry's could cheer me up. By the way, did you know that they're having a contest, and if you retweet their last post, you have a chance to win a trip to Vermont? I applied. I'd be really excited to win. Anyways, I felt like there was something wrong with me. He said everything was great. He thought everything was perfect. Maybe I'm just damaged. Maybe there's something wrong with me that keeps me from just being happy. The more I tried to talk to him, the tighter he held me, and the more I just wanted to run. I couldn't be happy. I couldn't appreciate or accept him for who he was.
Joseph Campbell has this concept he calls the hero's journey, and honestly, we have to accept that everything we do comes with consequences. The hero's journey teaches us that what can start out great and with promise, what can start out being amazing, can eventually bring its own problems. That means everything we do, no matter how positive, will have its series of challenges and obstacles. Yeah, everything we do is going to come with its own unique set of complexities and challenges and obstacles. So, what can we do about that? Can we go back? Can we take it back if things get too hard? Can we just stop or quit or let go? No. After we've started on the hero's journey, we can never go back. We've already seen that our past life wasn't good enough. And now, if we look back at it, it's gonna look even worse than what it did before. Yeah, you've started the series of self-transformation, and you have to complete it. You can't quit. You have to see the story through to the end. You're gonna have to accept the dark days. You're gonna have to accept the struggles, the hardship of love and breakup and of things that don't go the way you want to. And you're gonna have to find something after that fire, after everything is burnt down. You're gonna have to create something that is better, that was more complete, that was more fulfilling. It's so easy to blame the girl in this story. She was the one that left. He didn't have any problems. She seemed to constantly be creating problems. But why? Why was she acting out? Why was she not happy? Why was she not satisfied? Why didn't she feel good in that relationship? What made her feel trapped? Stay tuned for part 3 and the final conclusion to the story.